morning.
Across that river,
Family Fellowship Baptist Church. You guys are over here this week. I didn't even notice that. Happy Easter morning to you all. And I know that we're not celebrating together right now, but just rest assured that the first Sunday when we are all back together is going to be an absolute blowout of an Easter service and a Resurrection Sunday. And so we look forward to that, but we also want to acknowledge this day when Christians all over the world are celebrating the day where our Lord rose from the dead. And man, what a great testimony that is now when we are so separated, it seems, in so many ways. Today of all day, we should be reminded of why we are united, that because of Christ's death, burial, and resurrection, you and I are united as family, even though we're apart. And so, man, that is an awesome thing. And so we want to spend this morning celebrating that and reflecting on that. And this is the time where we would normally take our offering. All that's here is the music team and Brother Farrell, and we're all broke, so we're not going to pass the plate, but I want to tell you that we do have online giving available. Simply check out our website, ffbcjonesboro.com, and follow the link to give. We've had a lot of people trying that out for the first time, and if you're having any issues, call the office, call me, and I'd be happy to help you. Also, feel free to mail in your tithe or drop by the office. We will have, hopefully, a Dropbox installed this week, so you don't even have to see us. You can just drop it on and continue to stay safe. But with all that being said, I'm going to pray for us, and then we're going to continue our worship service. So let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, God, we are so grateful. As we reflect on the death, burial, and resurrection of your Son, Jesus, and what that means to us, that because he lives, God, we have new life. God, we have been made new. We have been adopted into your family, and we have received so many blessings and benefits because of Jesus. And God, we want to spend this morning of all mornings thinking of that, reflecting on that, and being thankful for that. God, I pray that for all of us, as we maybe fix our eyes on the different anxieties and issues in the world today, God, may you lift us, to lift our eyes up to see you and to reflect on who Jesus is. And God, looking forward to the day where we will be united with you in heaven because of Christ. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Join us as we sing, "What a Friend We Have in Jesus." What a friend we have in Jesus. All our sins and griefs to bear. What a privilege to carry everything to God in
my sin.
alone in my sorrow and dead in my sin. Lost without hope with no place to begin. Your love made a way to let mercy come in. When death was arrested, did my life begin. Ash was redeemed, only beauty remains. My orphan heart was given and lame. My mourning grew quiet, my feet rose to dance. When death was arrested, my life began.
Oh, your grace, so
thank you.
Bleeding from a beating, there's the stripes. Good morning, church. It is so good to be with you today. The day that we celebrate the death, burial, and resurrection of our Savior, Jesus Christ. On this most holy of holidays, Jesus will stand in the people's court. Men and women, boys and girls, will sit in judgment. As able preachers turn prosecutors, present their case against him. Charged with the crime of passion, it will be proven beyond a shadow of doubt that Jesus did conspire with the Father to commit a brutal and barbaric act of death and did willfully take part in the commission of said crime. The jury, hearing the facts and witnessing the evidence, will be asked to reach a verdict and answer the question, what will you do with this one called Christ? Like any capital murder case, premeditation must be established. And to do that, I must go to a time long ago, long before the crime of Calvary, to the councils of eternity past, to witness the transaction in glory. So I submitted to you the evidence of the words of Peter recorded in the book of Acts. In Acts chapter 2, verse 23, him, Jesus, being delivered by the determinate counsel and foreknowledge of God, you have taken and by wicked hands have crucified and slain. Long before the words, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, were ever penned, the cross was a reality. And that's why the scripture records the Lamb of God slain before the foundations of the world. Ladies and gentlemen, the death of Christ was not a crime of circumstance. It was not a crime of coincidence. It was not an accidental death. It was not the case of involuntary manslaughter. It was a case of premeditated murder. God conceived the plan. The Son consented to the plan. And together they carried out the plan. Premeditated murder, motivated by love, is further evidenced by the trauma in the garden. His own words prove the case against him. In Mark 14, 32 through 36, we read, "And they came to a place which was named Gethsemane. And he saith to the disciples, Sit ye here while I shall pray. And he taketh with him Peter and James and John, and began to be sore amazed and to be very heavy. And saith unto them, My soul is exceedingly sorrowful unto death. Tarry ye here and watch. And he went further a little, and fell on the ground, and prayed that if it were possible, the hour might pass from him. And he said, Abba, Father, all things are possible unto thee. Take away this cup from me. Nevertheless, not what I will, but what thou wilt." Jesus said, My soul is exceedingly sorrowful. Luke concurs when he wrote, "And being in agony, he prayed the more earnestly, as his sweat was, as it were, great drops of blood falling to the ground." The question that I raise this morning, why the intense struggle in the garden? You see, the answer goes to premeditation. First, there was an anticipation of the suffering that awaited him. In the garden, Jesus, who knew all things, could already feel the crowds or hear the crowds crying, "Crucify him." He could already feel the fist pummeling his face, his beard being torn from his flesh, and the spittle running down his cheeks. He could already feel the scourge falling across his back, digging deeper into his flesh with every blow. Why? Because it was a premeditated reality. In the garden that night, he felt the weight of the cross as he struggled up the Via Dolorosa to Golgotha. In the garden that night, he felt the nails driven into his hands and feet, the spear piercing his side. That dark, lonely evening in the Garden of Gethsemane, Jesus could already feel the life being drained from his body. So it is no wonder he cried, "Father, if there be any other way, let this cup pass from me." The realization of the suffering that awaited him would be sufficient to have caused his trauma. However, there was more. There was an anticipation of the sin that awaited him. Beads of sweat stained by blood fell from his brow to the ground. A look of horror etched its portrait upon his face as he groaned in agony, knowing that in the hours ahead, all the wrath of God, all the torments of hell would be unleashed upon him. The sinless Lamb of God was about to become sin, tasting death and hell for the very ones who very soon would cry, "Crucify." He knew the Father would soon lay on him the iniquity of us all. He knew that though himself sinless, he would become sin for us. He knew by the grace of God, he would taste death for every man. And so it is no wonder that he said to the disciples, "My soul is exceedingly sorrowful unto death." The soul of Christ shivered at the prospect of the suffering and the sin that awaited him. And if that was not enough, there was also the anticipation of the separation that awaited him. Soon, Jesus would cry, my God, why have you forsaken me?" Soon the world he came to save would reject him. Soon the disciples he loved would deny him. But for Christ, the most terrifying prospect of the cross was that even the Father would soon forsake him, leaving him to face the darkness of death and the horrors of hell alone. Now listen. When I think of Christ's struggles in the Garden of Gethsemane, and I hear him pray, "Let this cup pass from me," I thank God for the words, "Nevertheless, not my will, but thine be done." The evidence is overwhelming, but there's more. The trial before the governor. After his arrest in the middle of the night, Jesus was questioned by the Sanhedrin court, where he was found guilty of blasphemy. He was taken, battered and bruised, exhausted from a sleepless night, to appear before Pilate, the Roman governor. Finding the fault in the Lord, Pilate sought to release him. But because of the insistence of the religious leaders and a response to the cries of the crowd, he ordered Jesus Christ to be scourged and crucified. Jesus was taken to the hall of judgment, where he was stripped, body stretched, and hands secured to a post. A legionary with the heart of a butcher began to cut away at the flesh of the Savior with the thongs of his whip. With each descending blow, the leather thongs, like the blades of a knife, sliced deeper and deeper into the body of the Lamb, sending pain pulsating through every nerve, exploding in the brain, and reducing the Lord to an unrecognizable mass of torn, bleeding humanity. Fulfilling the prophecy of Isaiah, who said, "His visage was so marred, more than any man." What a horrible sight. But now hear me. Oh, what a healing service. For by his stripes, we are healed. Adding insult to injury, the Roman soldiers threw a robe across the shoulders of the Lord, placed a stick in his hand for a king's scepter, and a crown of thorns upon his head. "Hail, King of the Jews," they shouted as they marched around him, slapping him, spitting on him, and using the scepter to drive the thorns from the crown deep into the scalp. Finally, tiring of their sadistic sport, they tore the robe matted in blood from his back, and they led him away to be crucified. The heavy wooden cross was placed on his shoulders, and the procession of the condemned Christ, two thieves, the execution detail of Roman soldiers, headed by a centurion, began the slow journey along the Via Dolorosa to the torment on Golgotha. Arriving at the place of the skull, Jesus was thrown backward with his shoulders upon the wood. Expecting resistance, the soldier was amazed at the cooperation of the victim. But you and I know that it was for this reason that he came into the world. The legionnaire located the depressions in the Lamb of God's wrist, and he drove a large square wrought iron nail through the flesh deep into the wood. He then moved quickly to the other hand, repeating the process, and then to the feet. Secured to the cross, Jesus was lifted between heaven and earth. For 6 hours, Jesus suffered the indignities of men, and hear me, the indignation of God, crying out, my God, why have you forsaken me?" With his life flowing from him, he still found the strength to pray, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." With hatred being hurled at him, he still found the love to comfort a dying thief, saying, "Today thou shalt be with me in paradise." Then, as Jesus felt the chill of death, and as the last of those precious drops of blood oozed from his body, he cried, "It is finished," and he died. Remember, please remember, that his death was not in vain. He died that we might live. He suffered that we might be saved. He wore a crown of thorns that we might one day wear a crown of life. He endured hell so that we might enter Now, I thought to rest my case at this point, but there's something more you should know. The triumph at the graveside. Friday evening, just before the beginning of the Sabbath, the body of the Lord was taken from the cross and placed in a tomb by Joseph of Arimathea and Nicodemus. The tomb was then enclosed with a massive rock. The religious leaders had a guard posted at the tomb to see to it that the body was not disturbed or stolen away. Satan sent death and corruption to destroy the body of Christ. And just as a precautionary measure, a regiment of demons. Friday, by all accounts, was a sad, sad day. The disciples were afraid. They were discouraged and defeated. The one they thought to be the Messiah, the one they thought would deliver them from the bondage of Rome and usher in the kingdom of God, had died. Having forgotten the words of Christ, they failed to realize that this was only Friday and Sunday was coming. Neither stone, nor soldier, nor Satan could prevent what happened Sunday morning. On Good Friday, Christ became the atonement for our sin. On Resurrection Sunday, he became the assurance of our salvation. Or as Paul writes, O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? Thanks be unto God who giveth us the victory through our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And that's why we see him in Revelation chapter 1 as him who was, who is, and who is to come, which brings me to my closing argument, the trumpet of glory. Jesus died. He was buried. He rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven. He was seated at the right hand of God, and one day he is coming again. Only this time he won't come as the sacrificial Lamb of God. He will come as the sovereign Lord of glory. And I saw heaven open, Revelation 19. And behold, a white horse, and he that sat upon him was called Faithful and True. And in righteousness he does judge and make war. His eyes were as a flame of fire, and on his head were many crowns. And he had a name written that no man knew but he himself. And he was clothed with a vesture dipped in blood, and his name is called the Word of God. And the armies which were in heaven followed him upon white horses, clothed in fine linen, white and clean, and out of his mouth goeth a sharp sword, that with it he should smite the nations, and he shall rule them with a rod of iron, and he treadeth the winepress of the fierceness of and wrath of Almighty God. And he hath on his vesture and on his thigh a name written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Jesus is the Redeemer. Amen. He is the risen Lord. And one day he'll return, the ruler of heaven and earth. So, ladies and gentlemen, I rest my case. Jesus, in conspiracy with the Father, did premeditate, motivated by love, to commit the crime of murder. Christ died for our sins. The only question this morning is, what will you do with this one called Christ? May I suggest you receive him, that you love him, that you live for him, and that you share him with others. Father, in Jesus' name, we thank you for Christ who came. We thank you for Jesus who lived. We thank you for the Lord who died, was buried, and on the third day rose from the dead. We thank you for a Savior that ascended into heaven. We thank you for an intercessor that was seated at the right hand of God. And we thank you that one day Jesus is coming again, that where he is, we might be also. In Jesus' name.